Hello, Jack Davis here with a few tips on shooting with the new iPhone 12s and all their new features. First off, let's
start all the way to the right with panos. Nothing has really changed here. They are taking advantage of the new HDR3 technology and the new Deep Fusion to get the greatest dynamic range. So this is more or less tips for those of you who haven't been using panos as much as you should. First off, what you probably know is that little arrow, you can tap on it, and that allows you to start from the left toward the right or the right to the left. That also is what we're going to use when we do a vertical pano, because that means we can start from the top down, or tapping on the arrow, we can go from the bottom up. What you want to do is you want to start in the lightest portion of your exposure before you start a pano. And so let's do a pano. Specifically, the easiest thing, we're just gonna do a little side-to-side pano. You can see it does not have to be on a leveled tripod. This is taking advantage of the gyroscope built into the iPhone. Do not try a pano like this with your DSLR looking straight up into the sky. I'm gonna tap the start button, the shutter release. I'm gonna rotate it around. And I'm not going to hit the shutter to stop it because I'm using both hands to do the pano. I'm just going to slightly rotate it the opposite direction and it automatically stops it. And here is our pano. I see that I've cut off some. So again, tapping close. We'll come up here. Should have done a little previs. There we go. Tap. Rotate the opposite direction. Amazing pano. And as you can see, also another little reminder, in the upper left-hand corner, that little arrow is going to allow us to go back to where we just were, in this case, back to the camera. To do a vertical, like I said, I'm going to start where it's lighter up in the sky, hit the arrow, tap, we'll even start up here, tap, rotate down, and I can tap because it's right there. Okay, and there is our vertical pano. The other thing that you want to remember when doing a pano, let's say you're doing something like a sunset where your exposure is going to change dramatically from looking left toward center to right. Remember that if I'm looking at the sunset right now, we'll just say that that right there is the center of the sunset. I can tap on it, that's going to set my exposure, press and hold, it's going to lock that exposure and that focus. Now I can recompose to the right. For example, tap the shutter, rotate through, it's going to be exposed for the sunset, and when I go completely away from the sunset, it will continue the same exposure, not plugging up the shadows or blowing out the highlights. Swing the opposite direction, and I've got my pano. So, just a few tips. Also, remember that you've got your three different lenses, depending upon what iPhone you have, so I can easily get something like this. Okay. One last little tip that you may want to remember is that if you are working with something close up to you, even a still life or something small, you could shoot a sushi roll. I've done panos, sushi panos, which are awesome. But the closer a subject gets to you, the more you're going to want to rotate not around your torso. Like right now, if I'm rotating here, I'm rotating around my torso. What you want to do is rotate around what's known as the nodal point, the actual point of where the sensor is, or what used to be known as the film plane back in the olden days. And for that, what you're going to want to do, and let me just shift over to portrait so we can see each other. What you want to do is I'm going to take my finger and I'm going to rest it right on the case, right above the where the lenses are, and I'm going to rotate the camera around that point as opposed to around, you'll see that how the background is shifting. Okay, I'm rotating around my torso. You want to rotate around the lens. So that would be one other little tip when you're shooting a pano, is to try and rotate around the nodal point if the subject matter is fairly close to you. If it's at a great distance, it's the horizon line, it's a sunset, don't worry about it. Actually, to rotate around your torso is probably more stable because you can have two hands on the camera. Okay, so a couple things on pano. Now we're over on portrait. The first thing that you want to remember about this, it also has that same feature where you can tap to set exposure. And then when you tap to set focus and exposure, that's what it's doing when you tap on any of the cameras, you'll notice there's a little sun to the right of it. If you scroll up, you can change your exposure. Since I'm heavily backlit because I'm in the shadow here, did not get any direct sunlight on my face, I can do that. Tap and then stroke ever so slightly up, and that is going to set my exposure. So remember that for all your shooting. If I want to lock that and keep it consistent so it doesn't change, I can press and hold. That locks the exposure and focus, and then I can set that exposure up. But I'm blowing out my highlight, I'm blowing out my background. You gotta prioritize. I can't be in dark shadow and also get a beautiful background. But as you can see, that's actually pretty darn amazing how well it is holding that background. In terms of the portrait, if we go to the upper right-hand corner, you're gonna see two little options. The little hexagon here and a little f-stop. So I'm going to start with the f-stop because I've got a very open f-stop. As you can see at the bottom, it says it's imitating a f3.5. You can see I can exaggerate that, okay, all the way to an f16 where it's barely doing any blurring of the background. And I can take it to something like a more traditional, you know, portrait, maybe something like a 5.6, still softening the background, getting rid of distractions, and I'm not getting too greedy with this exaggerated shallow depth of field effect. Remember that this is a effect. This is not actually changing any f-stop. There is no such thing as a variable f-stop inside of any smartphone. There is no aperture diaphragm that's opening and closing. All of this is being done through computational photography. It is using the multiple lenses to figure out, or in this case, because I'm shooting toward me with only one single lens, it's using magical pixie dust to do its magic. So, one, don't get too greedy. You can set your f-stop before you start shooting. It is sticky. The nice thing is once you're done shooting, you can continue to change that after the fact, which is great. Next, I'm going to tap on the little teeny hexagon up there, and you're going to start getting your studio light options, okay, down here at the bottom. You'll notice the my default, much like my f-stop, is not the default for the camera. Mine is set to studio light, and if you'll notice, there is natural light and studio light. Studio light is automatically going to find faces and automatically going to brighten them a little bit, which I like as a default. If you're shooting portrait, there's a good chance you want your subject to be accentuated. That's why you're blurring the background. So you can, I recommend studio light. Contour light is going to be more aggressive with contours. It's good for still lifes. Remember, these new phones are now smart enough where they can be used for still lifes. You'll see some examples later on about still lifes being shot with the portrait mode. Contour light is fine. Other ones you have here, stage light, black background, stage light mono, and high key light mono. This is coming in with the new iPhones. If you have an older iPhone, you may not have this option. One thing to remember about this is this works. You can see the shallow depth of field, but I can come up here, and as I change my f-stop, it is going to change that effect of how much of the background is being blurred out, especially once I shoot it. This is just a quick preview right now that I'm getting. That's why you're seeing the flashing. Remember, this wasn't meant to shoot video with this effect. But here, there's another tip. If you want to shoot video like this, you can, as I am, simply by using the screen record function built into your control panel. If you don't know how to do that, that'll be another class. Okay, so I'm going to go back to a more usable f-stop and I'm going to go back to my studio light and simply hit the button, and I'm shooting with the portrait mode. Okay, we'll talk about editing later, but as you'll see, boy, that is the worst shot ever. I can change the different effects after the fact, so you don't have to worry about it, and you can fine-tune things like lighting as well as change that f-stop to exaggerate that effect. Let me get out of here quickly because that is hideous. Remember when you switch apps, by in this case I looked at a photograph while I was photographing, and that upper left hand corner, you've always got that little teeny arrow up there in order to get back to where you just were. Okay, that is a few tips related to portrait. You'll notice though now when me checking getting out of there, it also automatically stopped my autofocus lock because I was shifting around between different applications. It reset itself. That also, I have got a whole set of new icons that I didn't have before down at the bottom, and they were hidden before because I wasn't actually needing any of them. And the way to access these extra icons, which are going from left to right, the flash, the exposure, if you want to do a numeric value of exposure compensation, your timer, your filters, your studio lighting modes, and your f-stop. If you want to access those at any time, looking at the top, you'll notice that there's a little now yellow arrow, and when I click on that, it hides them, and when I click on it, it reveals them. So if you're ever needing any of these features, flash, exposure, timer, filter, or the portrait options of Studio Light and f-stop, that's where you find them, the little teeny arrow at the top. Okay, going over to the photo mode. This is where it gets kind of fun, especially if you have one of the new 12 Pros. The 12 Pros allow you to shoot in Adobe Pro Raw. Awesome, fantastic, groovy. Let's go ahead and use that. Here, let's do a different, rather than use that press and stroke up and down, let's do that little caret at the top. We're going to go to the plus minus at the bottom, and here is an exposure compensation numeric value. So that is 0.7 of a stop overexposed from the metered exposure. Okay, so looking in the upper right, you can see that I have RAW because this is a Apple 12 Pro Max camera that I'm using right now. So I can tap in to switch between RAW and Pro RAW. As a default, you won't even see that option. You have to turn it on within camera settings, which we'll do in a different video. But if you are a serious shooter of any flavor, by all means, take advantage of it. It is awesome and it's fantastic. We'll talk about that when we get into post-processing. I wouldn't leave it on as a default. You actually can't leave it on as a default. But you can, you do want to have it that you can see it in the upper right hand corner. So I use it for the money shot, you know, the sunset, the beautiful landscape, a portrait, low light. When I shoot infrared, I will shoot it in the Apple Pro RAW. It is only available on the 12 Pros. If you have not gotten one of the new iPhones yet, should you pay the extra money to get a Pro version? Absolutely. It is worth the price of admission just to have Apple Pro RAW because, as I'll talk about in other videos, its ability to retain all of the computational photography prowess that's built into the regular Apple native camera, specifically HDR3 and Deep Fusion, is worth the price of admission. Also works with night mode, and a RAW night mode shot is not to be missed. But going back up to the upper RAW, or upper right where we see RAW, I'm going to turn that off. Again, it's not, I don't typically shoot with it because it shoots so amazingly well because of these computational photography features that are built into it. But you'll notice that right next to it, there's this thing called Live Photo. You've probably seen it. You probably have, every time you shoot with it and you go into your camera roll, you see a little bit of movement. I leave it off. I'm not crazy about it unless I am doing some sort of special effect like motion blur, or want to do a cinegraph where just something like a waterfall is moving, just constantly moving, and yet everything else is razor sharp except for the water. Same thing with the motion blur. I can take a picture of it even without a tripod, do a 3-second exposure, and still have everything rock solid except for things that were moving, such as the water. The thing to remember when shooting in this mode, and you can see that it's turned on up here, is that it is shooting a second and a half of video, actually, prior to you pressing the shutter. In other words, it's constantly recording and throwing away video. Right now it's doing that. So when you press the shutter, as I'll do right now, you'll notice that as soon as I press the shutter, a little teeny yellow box comes up above, and I'll do that again. So I'll press the shutter. You see that live? That live yellow square disappears a second and a half after you press the shutter, for a total of 3 seconds, roughly 3 seconds of recording. A second and a half prior to you pressing the shutter, and a second and a half after you press the shutter. We'll talk about that more on its benefits and why you would use it. Keep it off as a default, because by shooting all that video constantly and throwing it away, it uses your battery a lot more. Your files are bigger, and because it's doing this emphasis on motion, it is not putting all that prowess into things like Deep Fusion and Smart HDR. So good for special effects. You'll see what we can do with it. Basically what you do is you look at the image, another great shot, and you swipe up. And now you have all your options associated with that, such as bounce, which is just going to be absolutely hideous. Another thing to remember when you're shooting with it, you'll notice how much it cropped in on the image. Because this is now video, you'll notice that there's very little movement in it, aside from me. The background is locked down, even though it was moving around. To do that, it has to crop in on the image as it aligns all of these numerous shots together. So remember that when you use live photo, pull back on your zoom, shoot a little wider because it will automatically crop, and you want to be still steady, even handheld, for a full second and a half before you press the shutter and a full second and a half after you have pressed the shutter. This is the case where using that little teeny feature at the top and maybe turning on your timer so you don't actually have to touch anything, you can come up here, and with live photo turned on, I can tap, and now I have got a probably still completely awful image, but you'll notice how rock solid, even though there was movement with me not being on a tripod. Okay, so that is the regular photos. Again, you can tap, press up or down to change exposure, or use the caret as I've got here, and I've already got a +7 exposure on it, okay, which I will turn off. Video, I'm not going to touch on video. We're talking about photography for the most part, though the video now has got the Dolby Vision, high definition 10-bit per channel video. Awesome, fantastic, groovy. I'm not using it now because I'm just doing a screen recording. To change the video settings, look up in the upper right hand corner. You can switch it. There's HD 60 frames a second. I'm tapping on the 3060, that's swapping. Tapping on the HD. HD is 1080p and 4K is 4K. So that is what those are, and that's how you change it. Slow motion is really cool, and again, you can change on the upper right whatever settings are possible to change. In this case, nothing is changing. And don't forget time lapse, especially now the new time lapse allows you to shoot night mode time lapse, which is absolutely fantastic. It's great. Set it up on a tripod. You can have it shoot for 5 minutes or 5 hours. It'll always create a clip that's just under 30 seconds is how that works. You cannot change the playback speed. That's based upon how long you are actually shooting. One last thing, almost forgot, under the photo mode, of course, is night mode. Now, the reason why I didn't get a little icon for night mode up above is that there's plenty of light. Even if I come up here, I'm not going to see the icon for night mode. So let's do a quick overview on night mode. And to do that, I'm going to shoot in infrared. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a nice Spencer's camera infrared filter. You can see how black that is. Okay, that's what I'm going to shoot through. That's how much visible light is going to come through this filter. And up until, I'd say, this iPhone specifically, maybe the iPhone 11, I was shooting infrared iPhone because it has night mode and it has RAW through things like Lightroom Mobile, that app. But the great thing, you can see a little bit of light is coming through there. But the great thing about night mode is that it allows you to shoot in very low light. And in this case, by the time I put this onto the Spencer 72 millimeter IR, it's a 720 nanometer IR filter, and it is a 72 millimeter lens. It actually goes right on top of any of the Apple cases, the new Apple cases. I can actually just put that on there. You won't see it because we're using the front-facing camera for the second. But as soon as I swap that around, I am looking at the world in infrared, which is just ridiculously bitchin'. I'm sorry, that's the technical term for it. So you'll notice as soon as I swapped, looking down at the icons at the bottom and also icons at the top, when I swap that, you'll notice that now I've got this option. It looks like kind of a moon, crescent moon with lines on it. And you'll notice it has an X on it. I'm not using night mode now. It actually has enough light that I could shoot without taking advantage of night mode, but I am going to take advantage of night mode because it will make a much better image, much lower noise. It's going to take all its seconds of exposure and combine that to get rid of noise. So I'm going to click, I'll click on the upper left just because you may not have that little drawer of options open. When I click on that, you're going to see it's still off. It still has that X on it, but at the bottom where it says off, I can manually scroll over and it will max out. In this case, this much light, I can max out at 1 second exposure, which is great. And you can go up to 3 seconds, sometimes more handheld. The gyroscope inside the iPhone knows what you're doing and won't let you do any more than roughly three seconds. If you have it on a tripod, you can go to 10 seconds, which again, awesome. All a benefit. We have a breeze here, and so all those leaves are moving quite a bit, and you're going to see what happens with the night mode and why it's so cool. So I'm on 1 second. The last thing that I'm going to do with shooting infrared or any night mode is I'm going to take control of that exposure because I want to set that based upon what I see. And I know shooting infrared, I can shoot a full stop overexposed and still retain tons of detail. So I'm going to click up on that little carrot that opens up my options at the bottom. You'll see there's my little exposure. I'm going to go a full stop overexposed. You can see now I'm getting some nice crisp highlights. There's still information in there. They're not being blown out, but it gives me a greater dynamic range. I am going to set it to raw looking at the top. Now that little raw thing is open. I still have my timer turned on. I know this is a lot to take in, but we will cover it more in lecture. I'm shooting a raw image in night mode, overexposed to full stop with a 3 second timer so I don't have to worry about touching the shutter. And I'm going to tap it now. Gives me the countdown. And there is my raw shot. We'll talk about editing raw files in another one. You can shoot it, you don't have to shoot raw if you can't shoot raw because you don't have one of the pros, that's fine. It'll work just great. It's just really nice to have that extra latitude of all the different exposures that it took right there. It took multiple exposures. Night mode, 1 second. They don't tell you. Using both Deep Fusion and Smart HDR, you're shooting at least 3, up to 9 Not even counting night mode. So, anyway, there's a few tips related to the iPhone 12's shooting capabilities. Hope you got something out of it. Let's continue on with more of a lecture.